Which table talks about ports? HTSUS Statistical Linux, right? Do you guys see this? Port of West Palm Beach is 5204. Port Everglades is 5203. What about Boca Raton? Is Port of Boca Raton here? Does anyone see Boca Raton? Fort Pierce, Lauderdale. Anyone sees Boca Raton? So entry place is not really a violation, right? Perhaps we do not know that. We have to look further, right? But perhaps Boca Raton is within the jurisdiction of Port Everglades. We do not know that. Do we have time to check it? Probably not. If we had time to check it, where would we check it? Where would we check it, folks? Jurisdictions of the port, geographical boundaries, and all that stuff are located in the general provisions. Part 19 CFR, part 101. Which talks about section 101.3, talks about custom service ports and the ports of entry. So this West Palm Beach over here in section 101.3, if I want to know geographical boundary, I would look at the executive order 4324, which was done in October 15, 1925, the day on which many of us were not even born yet. We have to look at that information to deal with geographical boundaries. So I think, I do not think customs examiners meant us to go that deep. I just went in there because I think it's a refresher for us to know the sections very well. Section 101.3 is section which has been tested, especially within the context of drawback offices. And if you do not know that, please review the general provision portion of this course. So entry place is not likely the violation, but the entry type is. That means that D is the best answer choice here. Three violations. Number one, 5 working day rule. Number two, 30 calendar day rule. And number three, entry type rule. Any questions? Five minutes. All right, before we move on, during the break, couple of pointers about this question were made. So the point about, we identified five possible violations. Five violations included diversion without permission, unauthorized agent diversion. Another violation included wrong entry place. And the three that we identified as solid, 5 working day rule, 30 calendar day rule, and entry type rule, where the entry for transportation and exportation was made instead of warehouse withdrawal for transportation exportation, because customs examiners clearly told us it was entered into the bonded warehouse. Now, the reason that we moved away from the entry place where Boca Raton versus Port West Palm Beach, and the reason we moved away from the unauthorized agent rule is because they were in higher degree of obscurity. The customs did not clearly state it. They kind of may have implied, right? But we were not sure. We moved to the higher degree of interpretation. And whenever you move from whatever is stated clearly on its face, from the text, whenever you move away and you start to do hypotheticals, you move into the danger zone from which you should stay away. And this is a danger zone, entry place, because we do not know where the geographical boundaries for the ports are. I did go into the section 101.3, but this is not... section 101.3 helps, but you also have to read that executive order, for example. And that executive order is a higher... brings higher degree of obscurity, and because this higher degree of obscurity is probably not a part of the violation, that at least not part of the violation that customs examiners want you to consider in your 3 minutes of the customs broker exam question that you have. And this diversion is also section 18.5 says it usually authorizes it. So there is clear presumption of that this type of thing is authorized, unless, of course, accepted. And we have no indication of this merchandise being accepted, which also brings higher degree of obscurity. So those two potential violations, because they have a higher degree of obscurity, we kind of point them out, but we do not take them into the consideration because it would involve too much thinking into it. We have to be involved in the guesswork. We have to look at the rules, at the law outside of the scope of even Code of Federal Regulations, such as executive order in the case of the entry place. This is why 1, 2, and 3 are solid: 5 working days, 30 calendar days, and entry type, as opposed to the diversion and the entry place, which are more obscure. So three violations are more solid than the other ones. And notice, even though we have two possibles, there is no 5 violations on the map. This means that 3 violations is the best answer under the best answer rule. Moving on. Time limit for entry. So that we already discussed. The 15 calendar days is a rule. You have to enter the merchandise within 15 calendar days after arrival at the port of destination. Customs examiners have tested it. And another test question is, what happens if it doesn't come to the final port of what happens if you do not enter it, do not do anything? And answer is, it goes into the general order, or GO. So diversion, discussion of our previous question, diversion. Merchandise may be forwarded under any class of transportation, sea, water, land, pipeline, if pipeline is appropriate, air, to any port other than the port named at the entry at the option of the agent. So as we saw in the previous example, we had a diversion from Miami to Port Everglades. So, of course, this diversion is a general rule. And there are exceptions, as we shall see in a little bit. But let's take a look at this example before we dive into the exceptions. Read the question first, as always. To facilitate delivery to Miami, which of the following is a correct course of action? And you have a bunch of answers: cancel inbound, after port arrival IT, wait until the merchandise to find an alternative, inbound, move the merchandise directly. So you scan through the answers and you immediately know that this is a merchandise in transit transportation inbound question. So with that in mind, you start looking at the fact pattern. So you're looking at the correct course of action. So let's see. Brokerage firm prepares IT entry. So what's the IT entry? Immediate transportation entry is when merchandise comes to one port, but you do not want to pay duties in that port, you don't want to clear entry in that port, you want to clear it at a different port. So you just put it on a rail, truck, or any other means of transportation, and move it to the port without doing customs clearance at the port of arrival. So the brokerage firm prepares immediate transportation entry. It wants to move the goods to the different port for customs clearance. By the way, do you have to have a broker to do the IT, to prepare 7512, to prepare the inbound shipment? No, you don't. It can be done by the carrier. After receiving authorization from US Customs, the final destination is New York. We do not know the origin, right? So it goes from point X, we do not know where, but it goes to New York. And then while the merchandise was on its in route to New York, the importer tells you that he sold the merchandise to a customer in Miami. So somewhere over here, it was sold to Miami. So what happens then? What can you do to make sure that it goes to Miami? So it's here, and all of a sudden you need to go to Miami. Do you have to cancel the inbound document? No. Do you have to return the merchandise to the port of arrival and file a new entry, immediate transportation? No. Remember the general rule, which says that merchandise may be diverted to any port at the option of consignee, and approval is not required. So no approval required, that can be diverted at the option. What I have to do is just from here, oops, New York, never mind, let's go to Miami and deliver it to Miami. So I just take a next exit out and move south. Yeah? So A is incorrect, B is incorrect, tell the importer that he needs to wait until the merchandise is delivered to New York and then find a new alternative. No, that's also not necessary. You do not need to ask permission. You can move. Tell the importer that the diversion of an inbound shipment is never authorized. Well, that's incorrect statement of law. 18.5, section 18.5 of CFR, Code of Federal Regulations, specifically authorizes such act. So D is incorrect. E, move the merchandise directly to Miami using the same document. Yes. Unless, of course, exception applies. Here we do not have any mention of exceptions, but there are exceptions, as with many things. First exception is a new transportation entry is required when the merchandise is forwarded to another port after being returned to the port of origin. So if it comes back to the port, then you have to file a new entry. Or if it's delivered to the port of delivered at the port of diversion. So port of diversion is what? Miami. So exception is, okay, never mind, let me take it to New York, I suppose, that's the mentality, then take it. I think, let me see, number three, port of destination. No, I think this one is not it. This one is not it. Let me check 18.5 real quick. Because I have a feeling that 18.5 port of destination is also the case here. Okay. So we have a diversion here. CD. Oh no, I was right. At the port or the port of diversion. Okay. Alright. So we're talking about diversion here. I'm correct. So this outline is correct.